Podcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Hello, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are. I take this opportunity to wish you a happy World Pulses Day. As you know, the World Pulses Day was proclaimed by the UN General Assembly in 2019 to recognize pulses as an important crop for global food. And before that, in 2013, also the UN General Assembly adopted a resolution proclaiming 2016 as the International Year of Pulses. So from 2019, you know, building on the success of the International Year of Pulses, this day has been observed to recognize the importance of pulses in diet as a healthy food, and also as a good food for the planet. So there's also a great contribution to the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. And in line with that, the slogan for this year's World Pulses Day is Love Pulses for Healthy Diets and Planet. So pulses indeed are very nutritious. Pulses are also very low on carbon footprint. So they have this very dual responsibility, which we want to recognize on this particular World Pulses Day. So on that note, the Alliance of Biodiversity International and SEAT thought it would be good to organize this webinar. Being a CGIAR center, an international agricultural research center that has a mandate on beans. And I consider beans to be the king of pulses. When you talk pulses, you cannot leave out beans. And most specifically, the theme of this webinar is about counting on bean research. So the contribution of bean research in catalyzing investments, increasing resilience, enhancing gender equality, and improving nutrition. So we have a series of presentations today. And the aim of these presentations is one, to raise awareness on the nutritional benefits of beans. Secondly, is to promote resilient common bean agri-food systems. So we're not talking about resilience in the sense of just environmental resilience, but resilience of the system itself, including the markets various shocks. So we will get a lot of insights and lessons from PABRA member countries. We will learn later about what PABRA does, the approach that PABRA uses to conduct bean research and to ensure that the research products reach the final beneficiaries. And then eventually try to draw some lessons on how we can transform production and consumption of beans so as to deliver healthy diets and a healthy planet. On that note, I'd like to welcome the first speaker, Juan Lucas Restrepo, who is the Director General of the Alliance of Biodiversity International and SEAT. Juan Lucas has a long history in leadership of agricultural research, various governance roles in the CGIAR, in the public and private sector over the years, and has been quite a champion for change, you know, in these times also that the CGIAR is undergoing a change process. So I welcome you, Juan Lucas, to make your welcoming remarks. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you, Josie, for your introduction and greetings to all. In preparation for this meeting, I had a very nice plate of beans for lunch a few minutes ago. So I'm energized and ready to celebrate with you this day of success, of a very long-standing track record of engagement and a very positive history. I would like to welcome all the participants to this webinar on pulses for healthy diets and plants. It's great to have us all here today, and it's especially great to have our longstanding donors that have helped PABRA develop, strengthen, and mature over time. Our great appreciation to the Swiss Agency for Development and Cooperation, SDC, to USAID, to Global Affairs Canada, to the Australian Center for International Agricultural Research, and also to the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. Thanks also to the many participants from the public and private sector, women and youth that are so important for this endeavor, that have partnered with us in this successful endeavor and are here with us today. Our alliance, the Alliance of Biodiversity International and SIAT, is very supportive of Global Pulse Day. It's a very important day considering the very significant and growing role of pulses, including beans, of course, as we heard from Josie, one of the key research commodities in the Alliance, where we have also remarkable achievements and impacts in both Africa through the Pan-Africa Bean Research Alliance, PABRA, and also in across Latin America, Latin and Central America. Through efficient, through effective and demand-driven research, we see beans are increasingly addressing several SDGs, particularly no poverty, as they are very important along a participatory and equitable valuable chains. In terms of no hunger, malnutrition, and food insecurity, we all know that beans are nutrient dense, but also we are seeing more nutritious products emerging, such as the higher iron and blended processed products. In terms of gender equality and women empowerment, we also see that even though beans are increasingly becoming a cash crop, they are able to remain in the hands of women and smallholders, which is absolutely important for equality and women empowerment. And of course, to ensure sustainable consumption and production, as they contribute to healthy agro ecosystems and they are part of cereal, roots and tubers, and other dominated cropping and food systems. So I would like to thank PABRA and the Alliance for organizing this seminar. PABRA remains one of the Alliance's flagship programs. And as we go through and we move forward towards one CGIAR, we will remain committed to work with the PABRA network to continue to improve every aspect of the bean value chain across Africa through the corridor approach. We are also keen to expand PABRA's impactful experience to other commodities and in particular legumes. And we're also appreciative of the support we have received over the years from various donors and PABRA members. So we keep committed and supportive. Looking forward, we see that PABRA's areas and domains can be adapted to other commodities as a proven model. We have been discussing through CGIAR change and giving PABRA's an example of inclusive and important strong governance within CGIAR and a governance structure that, given its strong engagement with national partners, ensures that their priorities are tackled upfront. So it's a demand-driven platform, which is something that has been clearly signaled in one CGIAR reform. This is a long-term approach, a continuous permanent improvement, which has proven to be very successful. It's also a multi-sectoral, a multidisciplinary approach that is able to offer specific products from a gender-inclusive lens in terms of varieties, complementary technologies, information, and evidence-based tools, different approaches, etc. It's also very dynamic in terms of adjusting the research portfolio to the needs of specific regions and to anticipate technological breakthrough and understand and foresee the evolution of markets. And of course, it's been demonstrating, and we will hear a lot of that today, how it's leveraging other investments along the value chain, its engagement with the private sector, small and large is quite significant. And it's been an alliance that has been proven to also enhance the skills and knowledge of researchers and clinicians. So congratulations to PABRA. Congratulations all on this Global Day. We see our PABRA model being recognized and awarded different awards, one of the as best innovators of the CGIAR network. For example, it was also co-awarded the 2019 edition of the 1 million Al-Sumaik Prize for Africa in the category of food security. So we again thank you all, and we hope that as one CGIAR, we keep engaged and able to draw from this great track record of innovation and impact at scale. So I thank you again and wish you a successful webinar.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, Juan Lucas, for emphasizing our role on not just research, but also ensuring that there's the complementary role we have in coordinating and ensuring that our products reach the ultimate beneficiaries. So next, I will introduce the leader of the BIN program, responsible for leading the development and delivery of BIN research products. He's also the director of the Pan-Africa BIN Research Alliance, Jean-Claude Rubiogo. Please go ahead with your presentation.
Thanks, Joseph, for the good introduction. Yes, I'll be talking about the...
In the meantime, I encourage participants to introduce themselves on the chat box, your name, the institution you're affiliated with as we go along. And if you have any questions, okay, you can put them on the questions box. Thanks.
All right. Yes. My discussion will be about transforming smallholder farmer resilience and improving nutrition of rural and urban consumers in Africa through demand-led research and the product as well. Sorry for... Okay, yes, the BIN, where is the BIN program within the Alliance? We have six research areas, and the BINs are hosted within the crop for nutrition and health. That's where the BINs are hosted. So how does PABRA is linked to the BIN program? In Africa, the BIN program is a member of the Pan-African BIN Research Alliance, as together with other 32 agricultural research systems in Africa. Across the three networks, so we have one in Eastern Central Africa called the CABREN. We have another one in Eastern in Southern Africa BIN Research Network, and we have another one in West Africa called the CABREN. So it was established in 1996.
Jean-Claude, sorry to interrupt you, but you are not sharing the screen. You're the presenter, but you're not sharing the screen, sorry. Didn't came the pop-up that told you to show your screen?
Yeah. Sorry, we were with the...
Sir, maybe there is the button, of the monitor button near the microphone. Okay, let me try to... Okay, perfect. Now we see that, but we are seeing the notes. Need to click on display settings. Please. Near show taskbar on display settings, you should be able to choose the full screen. Or we keep them like this.
Uh, Are you able to see?
Yeah, but yeah. We see with the notes. So if you want, we can keep it like this.
Okay. And then I'm not able to read.
Great.
Okay, perfect.
Perfect. Yeah. All right. Okay, thanks. So I was saying that it's a consortium of 32 national research systems, which are grouped in three networks. I've finished that, established in 1996. Also comprising a number of other partners from private sector, NGOs, pharma organizations, that provide a coordinated framework of research and development, which is unique in the region. So any particularity from each country can find a way to address food insecurity, malnutrition, incomes, as well as the ecosystem health, and to provide also an investment for private sector as well. So the Alliance, the former SEAT, is just a facilitator in the whole partnership, but it does not own this alliance. Right. Oof, I don't know what is wrong with the system. All right, so yeah, it looks we have a challenge here. So, and then if you look at, there's a convergence between one CJR and also what you have in Pabra, what we call counting on beans, the benefit derived from the beans are really converging with one CJR. So we have a seven products we benefit from beans, including social inclusion, wealth creation, we have nutritional and health benefit, employment opportunity. They also take care of environmental sustainability. For now, there's also a process of industrialization, value addition, which people can use either canning, or you can see from the next presentations, we'll be able to talk about it. They're even now making trade within the country, across the region, internationally. So if you look at also the different, under one CJR, there's also several benefit or impact area. We have climate adaptation and greenhouse gas reduction, nutrition and health and food security, which meets very well with what we have under PABRA, poverty reduction, livelihood, jobs creation. Again, we have also similar gender equality, youth and social inclusion, very important as well in terms of equity, social inclusion, and environmental health and biodiversity. So there's a lot of convergence between what PABRA does and as well what also the one CJR is aiming at. So if you look at how beans are relevant now and in the next years to come, this is a study which we did in East Africa region in two countries, Uganda and Tanzania. If you look at the projection of beans between 2015, 2020, and 2025, the next 4 years, the beans remain relevant both in urban and as well as in rural area. So that shows that yes, it will remain on the menu. Even if we go to a higher urbanization, we still have a lot of food which are required for beans. And then that's urban consumption. A consumer requires a certain product, which probably we'll see from the next presenters how they will be able to catch up with that market as well. So however, as the consumer become choosy, we need to be innovative and probably create more products based on demanded breeding or processing as well. So for quite some time between 2015 and now, we have adopted the BIN business corridors, which are looking on the consumer, the market demand, and then we develop a product based on that engagement of the consumer. So we're able to have consumption hub as really the driver of our research. So if you know what the market is looking for, the processors, then you can design your variety, you target your variety, you target your seed systems, you target your agronomic practices, you help farmers to adapt to climate as well. So that's how the production hub depend on the consumption. So this is very important because we could be able to understand the consumer point of view, the demand they're interested in, the type of beans, the products. No longer cooking beans for a certain time, people can process into short cooking or even ready to eat. So now, after that, in between, you have a distribution. But this is supported by resilience, supported by policy support, as we could hear from, you'll see from other presenters. Also, the inclusion of gender, the ICT, as well as also thinking about nutrition. So again, as you create this corridor, which is demand-led, which is market-driven, and actors are coming together, you certainly see that there is a good investment, not only from the public sector, but also from the private sector. And this creates that investment conditions, create opportunity for youth job creation along the value chain, as you will see from also other presenters as well. So if you look at it through this, the production hub, we certainly have jobs which may be created as a result of production, seed production, grain production, farmer input requirement, irrigation. So that really can create jobs. As you go to distribution, there's also, you hear from one of the presenters, we talk about threshing, how we came up with the threshing machines. We also have cleaning. They become services rather than, as you intensify, as you increase the production, so people tend to go to mechanization, try to offer services. You could also, again, you go to the processing hubs, you'll find now what you'll also hear from other colleagues who talk about value addition, sorting, grading. It becomes a service rather than just a mere work, but it becomes a service and somebody can earn incomes up to when you go to the end of consumption and the marketing where you have the product. And all this creates a really ecosystem where finance services comes in, information, insurance. So the whole complete ecosystem is created as a result of the BIN corridor. But again, this depends very, very well of the good product, the research products which we are able to offer. So what are these products which the research BINs has been able to offer and the private sector is able to really cash on them? We have the market, the farmer preferred and market demanded varieties. We have also been able to produce evidence-based studies and business case development. We have been able to also have improved agronomic practices, which provide input, but in that process also create jobs and business opportunity. We also have the skills and knowledge we support with the partners. We have also expanded public and private partnership. This again, we're able to expand what we don't have as a PABRA. We can leverage from other universities or other organizations to support private sector or to support national programs. We also have institutional innovation. That's where the corridor came in. We now have started with the digital agriculture. I think, again, one of the presenters will talk about it. And also wide-scale exposure. So this has been able to help us to have a good number of enterprise, 230 small, medium enterprise. Third of them, 30% will be women, women and youth. You'll be able to hear from them. Good number of enterprise in seed. And this has been able to translate into a good amount of seed. And this also translated to increased productivity across the region. Some countries, Ethiopia, Uganda, Burundi, moving to 1.567 as well from 0.5. 20 years ago. So that's really around 20 years ago. That's really a change, but you'll be able to hear from other colleagues, how do they make use of the products which PABRA has been able to develop as well. Thank you. Sorry for these interruptions.
Thank you, JC. JC is quite passionate about not just research, but also scale. And from a background in systems, you know, he now spoke about you know, the various services that can be offered throughout the bean value chain. So the work of FABRA really cuts across. It's not just varietal development, not just good agricultural practices, but also ensuring that markets are functioning appropriately, farmers are linked to markets, and that the corridor is really functioning. Now, to provide a very practical example of how research is conducted in such a way that it responds to client demands, we will have a partner, a member of FABRA from Rwanda, that is Anwarit Uwera. Anwarit is a bean breeder in the Rwanda Agricultural Board, who conducts research on you know, development of new varieties and also scaling of various technologies. Anwarit, if you can be able to load your presentation. Yes, it's visible. Please go ahead.
Okay. Hi, everyone. Yeah, my name is Anwarit Tuwera. I'm a bean breeder at Rwanda Agriculture and Animal Resources Development Board. So I'm going to present on demand-led breeding in action. So this will be a case for Rwanda. Next, please. Next.
Anwarit, I gave to you the mouse and keyboard control. So if you click on the presentation, you should be able to go next, okay?
Okay, thank you.
Welcome.
As an introduction, beans are priority for nutrition, food, and income security in Rwanda. So it's a primary source of dietary proteins and also considered as chicken of poor and vegetable meat of the wealthier urban dealers. It's also increasingly becoming a commercial crop with a monthly turnover of about $1 million, mostly in informal cross-border trade. Beans are important for health ecosystem, also ranked fifth in terms of volume produced after bananas, Irish potatoes, sweet potatoes, and cassava, as you can see on this figure, where you can see beans which are produced on 552,513 hectares per year. It's also beans are also produced in all agroecologies of Rwanda, either as bush or climbing varieties. Here, in other figures, you can see the evolution of crop production in metric ton from 2008 to 2019, when you can see the beans, the production has increased. The objective of RAB bean breeding program, the main objective is to develop farmers' preferred, market-demanded, and climate-resilient varieties. Then through developing and promoting the utilization of high-yielding, multiple diseases-resistant, marketable nutrient-rich bush, climbing, and snap bean varieties, promoting integrated soil fertility, diseases and pests, and staking management technologies that enhance sustainable productivity, strengthening linkages among actors in the bean value chain to facilitate adoption, competitiveness and marketability of beans. Then last, establishing partnership and collaboration with international researchers to broaden the skills and expertise for scientific excellence and resource mobilization. How we do collaborate with other partners? We have some activities where partners come in. As a trade discovery, we collaborate with Michigan State University, Baker Hillary Alliance Barbara through EcaBrain, US Davis, ACR. Then for molecular breeding, we do collaborate with Cacao Trust Foundation, ACR Hillary Baker. For conventional breeding, variety development, seed production and dissemination, we do collaborate with Alliance Barbara through EcaBrain, Agra Harvest, plus ACR Sangeeta Foundation, where we share some of our varieties in other countries and have been released in those countries within the EcaBrain network. And also, we also introduce varieties from the other countries from the EcaBrain network, and we release them in Rwanda. For capacity building, we collaborate with Alliance Barbara, a Cabrain, where we have breeders and technicians which are trained, especially in BMS and other trainings. We also collaborate with Agra for the short and long term, for short and long term training, Roforam, Cacao Trust, Michigan State, Hughes Davis. So we have a lot of breeders which have been trained through the funds from these partners.
Hello, Anwarit.
Yes, please.
Your slides are not moving. What we can still see is the intro. Okay, now it's moving. Now we see the objective of RAB.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, yeah, sorry. Okay. But for me, then I can't control. You can help me.
If you click on the screen, it should be able to move to the next slide. Yeah.
Okay. Oh, sorry. Then for the objectives, I've talked about the objectives. Then how we collaborate with other partners. I talked about different activities, trade discovery, where we collaborate with Michigan State University, Baker Ellery, Alliance Barbara, Hughes Davis, ACR. Then for molecular breeding, we collaborate with Katie, ACR, and Rebecca. For conventional breeding, variety development, seed production, dissemination, we collaborate with Alliance Fabrica, brand sharing our germplasm and also receiving germplasm from other networks. And Agra, Harvest Plus, ACR, Sangeta Foundation. For capacity building, we have been trained for short and long trainings through the fundings from Alliance Fabrica, brand, Agra, Roforam, Cacao Trust, Michigan State, and Hughes Davis. Yes. For us, we start by demand-led breeding approach, and we borrow this approach from SEATS. Although we have our own approach, but mainly we fall within this approach. We start by the product concept, where we do variety design, breeding and selection. We do discovery, proof of concept, and early development of varieties. Product evaluation and scale-up. We do. We continue the development and pre-commercial. And the life cycle management, where come commercial and we continue with the commercial. So as a starting point, we start by, sorry. Yes, we start by trait prioritization to respond to the demand. As you know, the market-oriented breeding and seed systems are the essential approaches to speed up of better and more acceptable variety diversity with better chances of adoption and higher bean productivity. Then we do this through multi-stakeholder platforms. We have business innovation platforms and another platform called Rwanda Bean Alliance, where traits are prioritized. So this figure is a result from the trait prioritization done in 2016. Where different stakeholders came together and the traits were prioritized, as you can see, where we considered also gender. The male and female ranked the trait as they want. So this was the result which came from this exercise. And this exercise is supposed to be updated after 5 years. Means that at the end of this year, we'll update the trait prioritization. Okay. After having our traits, we develop a product profile. By now, actually, for Rwanda, we have developed 8 product profiles. The first is large red mottled and medium red mottled, medium red, large red kidney, large medium sugar, medium white, medium yellow, and medium to small yellow. So we do consider bush and climbers, and we target also different agroecologies where we have low, mid, and high altitude. The target market also is considered, where we start from the national, regional, and international markets. We are planning to develop those varieties with the yield ranging between 2.5 to 4 tons per hectare. We also develop varieties which are tolerant to biotic and abiotic stresses, without forgetting the nutrition quality, iron and zinc contents. One example for the plan for variety replacements, we have one variety already. We got the variety to replace it, which was a very, very popular variety, RWR2245, a bush bean variety grown in the eastern south part of Rwanda. The target client were farmers, traders, processors, consumers, and the target market were local, regional, national, and international export markets. It is red mottled. However, it has been seriously attacked by anthracnose, and the yield reduced. So this RWR3194, which is a new variety to replace the 2245, it is showing high yielding compared to RWR2245. It also has a high iron and zinc content, ranging from 86 to 94, than 76 of RWR2245, and it's also resistant to a lot of diseases. For the current seed system in Rwanda, the system is working like this. For RAB till now is still producing breeder seed, pre-basic and basic seed. Then private seed multipliers come into the certified seed production. Then agro dealers are in charge of commercialization and distribution. Then farmers and other NGOs and other people engaging in grain production came in and get the seed for agro dealers. So for the current situation, we have 154 seed multipliers in the country engaged in seed production. And the production per season is estimated at 600 metric tons of certified seed, which are produced and disseminated within the country. Some of the major achievements, we have here our varieties, RAB varieties, which are really appreciated and commercialized. As you can see on this table, we have a number of takers and the volume they commercialized per year, which come to 59,000 metric tons. And when you see those varieties, our varieties, HIB's varieties, they are very popular within the commercialization. Yes, and if we talk about the variety development, one of our major achievements, over 100 bean varieties released have been released over 20 years, which several are released in other East and Central African countries, Burundi, DRC, Kenya, Ethiopia, Tanzania, and Uganda. As a proof of concept of biofortification in common bean happened in Rwanda, 10 varieties rich in iron and zinc and other micronutrients have been released in 2012. And the current adoption of those varieties is at 28%. Another impact, other impacts shown by the HIB varieties in Rwanda. Biofortified beans have been shown to improve work capacity. As you can see, people are making money. Two presenters will come in. One is Farm Fresh, which is processing the pre-cooked beans, and Elvis, which is also exporting the beans. And some of the variety are the HIBs. And also the high iron beans are increasing farmers' income, raised hemoglobin levels, and has shown positive effect on cognitive ability in Rwanda females and brain function. Adoption of climbing bean increases yield by 23% among adopters and has the potential to increase yield by 48% for the non-adopters. So the proof of these impacts, you can read them from these published papers. Ben, from what we have been doing at the RAB BIN program or RAB, we have a vision to move forward. We are looking to continually develop more superior farmers preferred and market demanded varieties, accelerate variety access in partnership with private sector, engaging policymakers to continue supporting bean value chain development, including research, increase the adoption of HIVs, strengthen linkages between key value chain actors, reinforce contract arrangement among value chain actors, increase farmers' awareness on the use of quality seed, and ensure the sustainability of seed supply in the system. Thank you so much. Thank you for your attention. My presentation is ending by here. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Anwarit. Her presentation actually gives a clear picture of how the research is demand-led. The slide that showed the various off-takers and the volumes that they operate with, that is really the starting point. The volumes they operate of which market classes. And with that information, then, the breeding program works backwards to look at trades, to look at product profiles, and then develop research products that respond to that market demand. So that at the end, it's really research that is driven by a particular market. Now, I encourage the presenters to try and stick to 8 to 10 minutes so that we're able to finish on time. I'll give an opportunity for a few questions, and I encourage everyone to write down their questions on the chat box. There's a question from Nick Van Wies related to the production. Anwarit, in your introduction slide, you showed increase in bean production, but there was no information on bean productivity. Could you shed some light on the increase in bean productivity over that period? Anwarit?
Hey, Josie. Yeah, the productivity also has increased because, before the adoption of this improved variety, productivity was 0.8 to 1 ton metric ton per hectare. Then when we compare those farmers who use the improved variety, we see the increase in productivity now. It has increased from 1 to 1.5 metric ton per hectare.
Thank you, Anwarit. So linking the presentation from Anwarit with the off-takers and the processors, and we'll have two off-takers processors from Rwanda, and we're going to begin with FarmFresh. Christian Hermans, if you are available, please load your presentation. Christian has a very interesting story because he dared to get out of the rat race of the corporate world. He was working in the UK as a consultant and then, visiting various parts of the world. And he was driven to look into nutrition and value addition and started a food processing, specifically bean processing plant in Rwanda, which now, even exports to Kenya and other parts of the region. So, Christian, please put on your presentation.
Good afternoon, all. I hope you can see the presentation.
Yes, please go ahead.
So thank you very much for the introduction. So my name is Christian Hermans. I'm the founder of FarmFresh. I set up the company in 2015, and I used to be the CEO for the first 4 years, up to late 2019. So basically, just to give you an overview of FarmFresh. So FarmFresh was set up in Rwanda in 2015. And basically, the rationale at the time was that I wanted to do something in agriculture. We looked at what was actually possible to do in Rwanda. And we looked, first of all, at statistics about production. I mean, we saw that one of the most produced crop basically is beans. So beans is produced on a massive scale, I will say. But there is no value addition being done. At the same time, the bean per capita consumption in Rwanda, I believe, is the highest in the world. I mean, people eat beans on a daily basis, It's a very cumbersome, I will say, activity to do to cook beans, because it takes a very long time. I mean, it takes about 7 hours if you count the soaking time and the cooking time. So we actually came up with this idea of actually offering pre-cooked beans to offer the convenience of beans, but basically to have those beans ready in a few minutes. So we actually came up with the idea of offering pre-cooked beans in pouches. We actually created two products. One was mixed beans, which is basically a local, I mean, the common beans, we'll say in Rwanda. And the other one is high iron beans. It's basically beans which have a higher level of iron and zinc, huh? But they basically have the same taste, so they are much, much better nutritionally. So we actually basically set up the company in Kigali, and we actually decided to work directly with smallholder farmers. So we bought directly from cooperatives, and the beans were processed in the factory in Kigali. Initially, it was for the local, I would say, retail markets, but quite soon we actually ventured into schools in Rwanda, and later on in supermarkets in Kenya. As well, what was very important to us was to create impact. And we saw that with FarmFresh could actually create significant social and environmental impacts. So what we calculated that by working directly with farmers, we will be able to increase their income by around 26%. And at the same time, beans is basically mostly grown by women. So we will also have a big impact on gender. Different studies also show that by basically moving from regular beans to pre-cooked beans, you will actually halve the amount of charcoal that you will use per year. I mean, there was a study that we conducted in Uganda that shows that with dry beans, you need about 288 kilo of charcoal per year, and you need about half for processed beans. There is also a significant reduction in greenhouse gas emission. If people will be able to actually switch from cooking beans the traditional way, I will say, with charcoal to pre-cooked. We also did a study in Rwanda that shows that basically for every school, if you count the number of trees, it's 324 trees per school per year. So it has a massive impact on deforestation. So we came up with a simple, I would say, production process that will actually allow us to actually make pre-cooked beans in a way that will keep the taste and the freshness of the beans. Because here, we actually, beans are actually processed in pouches, and the pouches go into an autoclave. And what is actually interesting with that is that we only need to add water and salt. So we don't put any preservatives or any type of other products, I will say. But what is good is that the product can actually stay on the shelf for 1 year without being refrigerated. And this was actually certified by the Rwanda Standard Board, so we're actually meeting all the quality standards. But what I wanted to focus on mostly is the solution we are providing, I mean, that FarmFresh has been providing to schools. Because what we realized very quickly when we started the company was that there was a very, very huge consumption of beans made in schools across Rwanda. And the thing is with schools that they go through the same process as, I would say, regular households. I mean, you know, cooking beans, they take a very long time. In most schools, they will be starting at around 4 or 5 a.m. to actually, you know, prepare lunch. And the consumption is very high. I mean, based on the studies that we did, we realized that for an average school of around 300 students, the consumption is at around 3 metric tons per month. And basically, and beans are served for lunch and dinner. What we also saw is that it is actually very expensive for schools to cook beans because it takes a lot of energy, and most schools basically use firewood. And in a country like Rwanda, getting firewood is actually becoming an issue. There is also a lot of price fluctuation with firewood. I mean, in the dry season, it is actually, I would say, cheaper. And in the rainy season, it becomes harder and expensive. So schools are actually also looking for basically a solution. So what we did, we actually offered, you know, our FarmFresh high iron beans to schools based on, you know, a lot of research that we did with SIAC Pabra, with consumer preferences, to actually make sure that we would actually come up with a product that will actually meet everything that schools are looking for. Convenience, I mean, basically that the beans can actually be cooked right away, so it takes about 5 minutes to prepare them. They don't actually need water. They don't need much firewood, very, very small amounts. And also we did price calculation, because for most schools, one of, I would say, the most decisive factor to make a decision is the cost. I mean, even though the product can be much better, the budget for most schools is quite limited. So based on the price comparison that we did, we actually made sure that we could come up with a product that was 5 to 10% cheaper than dry beans when you add the cooking costs. And at the same time to sign, contract for the whole year with schools. So basically schools will have the guarantee that, the supply will be consistent and the price will not fluctuate as compared with, dry beans with the price fluctuation in the season and the firewood fluctuation. And at the same time, nutrition was a key selling factor as well, because we were able to clearly show, studies clearly showing that, high iron beans is much better than mixed beans. I mean, you have more iron, more zinc. It helps with fighting anemia, improving concentration. So there are a lot of benefits, and of course the environmental benefit, as I explained earlier. Then we looked at the overall market opportunity. So it's a very, very big market, the school market in Rwanda. I mean, here I'm just talking about Rwanda. I mean, if you count the region, Uganda, Tanzania, I mean, it's massive. So for Rwanda, I mean, we basically saw that there are around 3,000 schools. And the enrollment population is 3.4 million. So us at FarmFresh, I mean, the target that the company put itself is to reach 500 schools in 5 years. But by being able to do that, I mean, the company will be processing 1,000 metric ton per month, which is actually quite high. So in late 2019, I mean, all the preparation were made for that. I mean, new equipment was acquired, new packaging, to actually, be able to serve that market. So basically the product for schools are sold in different packaging, because schools want convenience. So basically it's in large, 5 kilogram, 10 kilogram and 25 kilogram packs. The only, I would say, drawback or negative aspect that FarmFresh faced was the COVID-19 situation. Because as you all know, most of the schools in the region were closed. I mean, in Rwanda, schools have pretty much been closed for the past 1 year. So it clearly affected the plan. So the company had to fall back on other markets, I mean, such as the regional market and the retail market. So again, to emphasize on the impact, that basically this is depending on how the COVID situation will evolve, which is very difficult to predict. But the impact are clear there for the company. First of all, FarmFresh will be able to provide a clear increase in nutrition for schools. And as I mentioned earlier, it's a very large population of around 3.4 million people in Rwanda. Affordability, so it will provide a clear impact on basically cost, because for schools, I mean, it's still very, very critical. Environment as well, which is a very big aspect for a country like Rwanda, which is highly populated and small in density, as well as providing a high level of income to farmers and generating jobs. So thank you very much. I mean, this was an overview of everything that FarmFresh has been doing. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, Christiana. Your presentation, links quite well with the slogan of today, Love Pulses for Healthy Diets and Healthy Planet. So you've spelled out, the micronutrient-rich beans that you deal with. You've shown the environmental, the way you contribute to the environmental conservation, through the process of processing these beans and value adding. And cooking beans also is something that a lot of people are wary of. Sometimes they take hours together, and even for urban consumers, getting these beans that are pre-cooked, which you can get ready within a few minutes, is something that is quite convenient. So thanks for that presentation. And again, I encourage participants to put in their questions in the chat box. I'll look at a few questions from the chat. There's a question to Anwarit related to the bioavailability of iron in beans after cooking. Bearing in mind what I just mentioned, that we cook beans for a very long time, sometimes even take out the water that we've used for cooking beans. So would the beans still have the iron, that would be useful for the body after cooking? Anwarit, can you respond to that?
Thank you.
Thanks, Joseph. Yeah, we have not yet done a study, a research on this. We'll do that and get back to you.
Another question relates to, you know, it's really interesting, yeah, the consultation that takes place with the users of these varieties. And you mentioned that this consultation is done every 3 years. So the question from Kutso is related to how long it takes to release a variety and whether it's related to this 3 year period of consultation. That's for you again, Anwarit.
Okay, thank you. I said that it takes 5 years, not 3 years. For releasing varieties, let's say the last release took place in 2012. Till now, we have not yet released other varieties, although we applied for release for 15 varieties. And among the 15, we have 8 high iron beans varieties with the iron and zinc content higher than the ones released in 2012. Our application was approved. Then we were supposed to release last year. Due to COVID pandemic, we didn't. Although even those varieties are not yet released, they are now in the pipeline of commercialization. We are intending to increase the seed production of those varieties after the release. So as at the end of this year, those varieties will reach more farmers than the ones reached by now. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, Anwarit. There are a couple of questions related to whether we will share the presentations after this. Yes, we will. Then there's a question to FarmFresh. Maybe you could talk a bit more, Christian, about the type of packaging you use for the pre-cooked beans, keeping in mind the environmental aspects.
Yes, so basically it is packed in pouches. So it's biodegradable pouches that basically they are very specific to this type of cooking technology, to autoclaves, because they have to basically withstand the temperature and time. So because the way it is done, I mean, basically cooked beans are actually packed raw in the packaging with salty water. And basically the beans cook inside of the packaging. So basically it's in pouches.
Thank you. So I'd like to introduce the next presenter, Elvis Ruema, who is the CEO of Best in Rwanda Group. Best in Rwanda is involved in, you know, processing seed processing and export of premium grade beans, even outside of the African region. Elvis, could you load your presentation? And it's interesting to note that most of the presenters here who are in the processing industry, or even the researchers, are quite young. So. This is a business that really could contribute to enterprise development for the youth. Elvis, over to you.
Thank you, Jose. As you have introduced me, I'm Elvis Ruema, and I'm very happy and honored to be part of this event of celebrating the World Process Day. I'm the CEO of Best in Rwanda Group, which is an exporting company of premium grade beans, regional and international markets. So I'm going to share with you my presentation.
So the presenters can also monitor the questions and try to respond on the chat to various questions. Thank you.
Yes, as mentioned, I'm a CEO of Best in Rwanda Group Company. The Best in Rwanda Group Company is a company which started in 2018. And we started with the objective of supporting dry beans with premium grade to regional international markets. since that time, I was in trip in Dubai. Then I get in touch with some people in the Middle East, and I was passionate with agribusiness, especially in innovation of agri products in the also in the export market. Then I got to know that there's some opportunities in the Oman market. Then once I came back, I started seeing how I can start the business based on the figures. Also, my colleague Christian said about the how Rwandans are familiar with growing the beans. So I got to very excited to start this business. So since we started, we were of course targeting the Oman market, and till now we are now employing 9 staff and approximately 30 casual workers. Among them, we have 28 women and 3 men. And the target market for now, as I said, it was Oman, and we got to get another chance of participating in international exhibition last year in Berlin. And we got to have a new market in France and Belgium. And now everything is supplied under the Nzuri Beans brand as our commercial brand. So the vision of this company is to be the preferred exporter for premium grade dry beans, both in regional and international markets. So I'm going to briefly share with you our production approach, which is based on the research program of the Rwanda Rwanda Agriculture Board here. And the way we structure our production line is that, first of all, BRG identifies the market, either in region or international markets. Then we identify, first of all, the type, the variety, and we approach the Rwanda Agriculture Board under the bean program. And then we ask for enough proper information about the seeds, availability, and the adaptability of those seeds also on certain and specific areas. Then they give us all needed information, technical ones. Then they link us with the certified seeds producers in those certain regions. And then when we are in touch with those multipliers, we link them with the farmers in those regions as well. So then we, through that approach, we link our market with the farmer cooperatives in those regions. So maybe I didn't go step by step, but briefly, that's how all the steps are done. I would like to introduce more why we came up with this approach. It's because since we started, our target, as I said, is premium grade, well-sorted, single varieties. And on the ground here in Rwanda, it was very difficult to find such grades. So we got an idea of making a consortium of different bean actors, either farmers, input dealers, seed multipliers, but also with the support of government, RAB, and also FABRA, CIAT in Rwanda. So then we got a big support from those institutions in coordinating that consortium, which is the approach I was presenting to you right now. So then the targeted bean types are now yellow, sugar, and red kidney beans. So for now, we are implementing the production scheme in 4 districts in Rwanda, which are Rutsiro, Nyabihungu, Rero, and the Ngoma districts. We got last year chance of introducing the new project, which is in line with our production approach. And that project was supported by IDH. And the way this project will work, I mean, or it's working since last year, it has the main objective of building a sustainable supply chain by engaging 2,000 smallholder farmers to produce and source premium quality of dry beans for local, regional, and international markets. So, and the project also shall provide the extension services in the aggregation centers to farmers, which shall support the current business activities to continuously source from them and from this year 500 metric tons of beans and up to more volume in the near future. So this project came at the right time because these are kind of activities, it's not easy to monitor them and coordinate them while you're also in business. So with such support, this helped us a lot to see how we can really intensify this bean value chain in Rwanda. So, and as I was saying, the engaged farmers now in the project, we have 203 youth, and we have 1,026 men, we have 771 women. Then in general, the total number of women and men, as you can see the ratio, we have men who are on 56% and women on 44%. So I'm going to share with you quickly some of the current products we have now. We have two types of packaging. We bulk in 25 bags, as you can see on the first picture. They are branded on the Missouri beans brand, and we have other types of small packages, as you can see on the other side. And here on the bottom, these are not the packaging we have now. These are the sample package, the sample we brought to the exhibition. I was telling you about the different varieties which are grown in Rwanda. So, as you can see in the up in the corner, those are the branded small package in the boxes. So those boxes are have the capacity of 10 kgs each box, with 10 packaged plastic packages inside, or 20 if they are 500 grams as well. Our production now is, I'd like also to share briefly how the production is. Since 2018, we managed to sell 320 metric tons of premium grade beans on local, regional, and international markets. So from this year, 2021, BRG will source 500 metric tons per year from contracted farmers under 20 cooperatives, with a projected volume of 3,000 metric tons up to 2025. As you can see on this chart, the first one, you can see how in 2018, we started with about 46 metric tons per year, and now we, up to 2020, we have increased since that time up to 320 metric tons. And as you can see, the projected also projection of our beans, our volume, we range in 2021, it will be from those 500 metric tons up to 3,000 or even more in 2025. So I would like also to introduce to you how we are planning to make our basic low, I may say that they are raw beans, still they are just with a sorted grade, with premium grade, but we would like also to add some value on them in a short period in the future. So we have the plan of working closely, which it has already started with the support of the funders of the project. We are now working closely with the export international food safety standards and certification to see how we can apply for fair trade certification. I mean here for the company and the farmer cooperative as well. So that will help us sell our products on a high-end market, I may say, with a good return on the farmer side, good return of revenue on the company and on the farmer side. That will help us to be more sustainable on the market, and also to create more sustainable market with our cooperatives. So the second plan is also to explore on developing and promoting pre-growth products in order to increase bean consumption in Rwanda, in the region, or even internationally, and reduce time spent in cooking and create more sustainable markets for bean farmers. Among these, those products will be pre-cooked beans, cookies of this week, and also some ready-to-eat snacks. So the current challenges we have, we may say that we have two types of challenges. The first one is about the general challenges, which on the farmer side, I may say high cost of certified seeds. The farmers still have the problem of accessing, affording the certified seeds, because the government isn't include the subsidy as in the bean seeds as they do in other seeds. So we are trying to see how with the Rwanda Agriculture Board, we already share that experience, so that we hope that in the future maybe those farmers can afford the certified seed with an affordable price. So we have also lack of mechanized farms, which may help us to improve the yield production. And also some of the, it's a common issue, but which we are trying to address now in this project, which is a high cost harvest losses on the farmer side. And also lack of more scientific and technological driven farming. High interest rates on the business side, we have a challenge of the high interest rates and limited access to finance to support the bean export business. Here I will say that it goes with the scenario of beans and how the terms of payment back or something like that. We're still in contact with banks, but in general, the sector of beans in Rwanda wasn't really recognized before as a profitable business sector. So other challenges also related to COVID-19, the first main challenge is a limited labor in the operating hours, as we need to manage time and manage number of people must be in the factories and so on. And also the cost of fluctuations on the produce and shipping, either here, when we produce when we get the produce from the farmer, sometimes the cost of the operations occur because of these challenges of pandemic, COVID-19 pandemic. So also we have other difficulties in making the business projections, where sometimes the borders are closed in some of the other countries. And also you can't get any good clear picture from the customers of how much beans they are going to order in certain time because of this pandemic. So I would like also to share with you the future business outlook. The first thing we are targeting is increase the volume of supply sourced from
Elvis. I encourage you to wind up.
Yes.
Okay, thanks.
Hello?
Please carry on, but try to wind up.
Okay, I'm about to finish. Okay, the future business outlook is about increasing the volume of supply sourced from potato farmers and increasing warehouse capacity to build and manage for service losses, reduce production costs by farmer trainings and pre and for service handling, raise capital to increase on dry bean supply, also accessibly penetrate new markets, also pursue necessary internationally recognized crop certification, and also investing in the processing and value addition. So we are also targeting in this year to build this warehouse so that they help us also to conduct our activities. So thank you so much. These are some of the pictures I would like to share with you why we're celebrating the International Process Day, special for the beans. The first picture you can see is our packages, and the others are markets, and the other are the food plates with the beans there. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Elvis. So I encourage again participants to enter their questions in the questions box, and the presenters to, you know, monitor the questions that are coming through, so that they can be able to answer them, so that we move faster. So now we move further south to Eswatini, Tina Dlamini, who is the director of Smiling Through Investments, STIN. Please load your presentation. Yes, please go ahead.
Thank you very much. I hope everyone can see my presentation.
Yes, I put it on presentation mode.
Yes, I think it's clear. It's a good evening to everyone. My name is Tanat Lamini from Smiling Through in the Kingdom of Eswatini. I'll be sharing on the insights from a youth on integrated bean value chain, focusing on seed production and bean processing. So basically, according to the 2020 global report on food crisis, more than half of the 135 million actually food insecure people in the world in 2019 live in Africa, a continent where we are in, which is approximately 73 million people. So to meet the food shortages in Africa, Eswatini especially, Smiling Through, which is a youth-owned business with two men and one woman, integrated a bean value chain, which was established in 2013 while we were students at the University of Swaziland. And then after graduating in 2016, we legally registered the business formally so that we operate full-time. So we started to rent a 29-hectare farm in Malkins to produce bean seed, which is ensuring that food security fully depends on seed security. And then also focusing on bean grain production to ensure we cover the whole hectare of the 29 hectare, and then do our crop rotation with green mealies and vegetables, high value vegetables like baby vegetables, to ensure that we maintain our cash flow the whole year round when we do not have a bean crop. So we promote production and consumption of beans through value addition, which I'll be sharing while I continue with my presentation. And then we have a number of partnerships and collaborations with around our country. So through our collaboration with the National Bean Research Institution and the Pan-African Bean Research Alliance, we've been able to produce basic and certified seed bean varieties released by our Department of Agriculture Research, which is on the national variety list. With the support from PAPRA, we've been able to do all those basic and certified seed production. And then also commercialize a processed bean-based food product developed by the Department of Agriculture Research, with PABRA backing and supporting the processing of bean-based food product, which is the bean gem made from biofortified beans, which are high in iron and zinc contact bean. So ensuring that we value it and ensure we increase our market share and the way people can view beans, not something for the poor. And then our growth in terms of seed production since 2013, we've managed to produce three bean varieties working with farmers, which 87% being women and youths, because they are the ones who are available in rural area homes, mostly affected and hit by frozen things to do. So in 2016, we managed to produce tons of nut yellow. We lost it because our research department no longer have the basic seed or the certified seed. So we're doing it with seven farmers who were outgrowers and ensuring that we produce that seed. And then in 2014 to 2016, with four groups of farmers, we managed to produce 5 tons of NUA 45, which is the red mock-lit bean. And then with Cranscope, which is the red speckled sugar beans, this one is highly common in our southern, in the southern parts. We managed to produce more than 20 tons of seed from 2014 to 2020 with 15 farmers who were on our outgrower program. So and then from the seed, we move on to the grain production, some land market linkages managed to gain. So trading two main bean products in terms of grain production, which is Cranscope and NUA 45, and about 70% of the farmers involved are women and youth. We managed to produce 35 tons in 2019 of the red mock-lit bean NUA 45 with five farmers in different locations of our country. And then red speckled sugar beans, which is the Cranscope, we produced more than 50 tons in 2020 with 10 farmers group. And then our main anchor buyer is the World Food Program of the United Nations. Since 2019, we've started a smallholder program to buy straight from farmers instead of buying from traders. So we've really benefited from that program by the World Food Program. So with COVID-19 hitting on our side, it has really caused a high demand of grain, something which we didn't have expected and we didn't have a plan. So we just reacted to the situation at hand because COVID-19 just came unexpected. So in the farming season 2020 to 2021, we're targeting 200 metric tons so that we're able to cover for the demand of grain locally. Already we had a lot of changes. And then technology and value addition in 2016, through the Coca-Cola competition, we managed to help get a support of funding of around $20,000 to secure a bag filling and stitching machine, which we use to seed grain and seeds. And the seeds are packaged in 10 or less bags so that the farmers can be able to get it in different shops like by cash. And then we started a value addition project after finding some research which was done by our Department of Agriculture Research of bean gem. So we had to commercialize and ensure that we multiply it. So the franchise model will be used to market the bean, this product within the region. And in 2020, more than 35 tons of beans have been used to produce different bean-based products, more which is the bean gem. And then we also do some baking with the bean gem. So most people were shocked that can you have a gem from beans, because it has high nutrition content with proteins compared to the other beans, which has more sugar. So this one has some proteins and natural sugars from the beans. And then challenges we face, and looking at the future, regardless of the challenges, we had a big challenge to access capital finance from banks. Because as young people, we smiling through 100%, you'd want the banks will want immovable collateral. We don't have land, any immovable assets. So we were the collateral with our business ID. So it was a big challenge to unlock and ensure that financiers understand our business model. Slowly but surely, it's opening up. And then with COVID-19, it has an effect on the availability of inputs, seed and fertilizers locally, a lot of shortage because we didn't plan for COVID-19. And then even the market, there's a lot of changes, more demand than the supply we have, as well as labor issues due to COVID-19 heating up and ensuring to comply, as well as transport issues, because a lot of the transportation industry was affected due to travel restrictions. And another challenge was the shortage of grain for value addition. For us to do a lot of the value addition, we need consistent production from smallholder farmers. So the production for the grain is still less than what we demand, what the value addition demand. But the future looks brighter. We have managed to get additional bean processing equipment that have been provided through the SDC COVID-19 Response Fund support to enhance production and expand supply to school feeding program. So kudos to that support from partners through PAPRA, as well as increasing youth and women agro-growers interest so that we are able to cover up for the shortages. And then we are looking forward to expand the franchise model for the bean jam in the SADC region, South Africa, Malawi, and we've already started those collaboration, as well as look to export to the US and EU within the region, like the likes of Christian, who recently presented, looking to collaborate and expand our model as well. So thank you very much for listening attentively to our presentation.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. For those who are aware of the Young Professionals Platform for Agricultural Development, YPAD, Mr. Dlamini is also the representative for Eswatini. And he's actually putting, you know, youth in agriculture into practice. So now I'll invite Alfred Chengula from Tanzania, who is going to talk about mechanization and breaking the myth that mechanization will mainly benefit large farmers. So doing some work previously on seed systems and looking at where the major cost factors are in seed systems, PABRA identified that threshing is one of the major costs. So based on this, you know, there are a series of trainings of local artisans on mechanization. And Alfred has taken this forward in developing some portable threshers that can also be used by small scale farmers. So Alfred, please load your presentation.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Alfred Chengula. I'm from Tanzania, and I'm a young entrepreneur from Arusha in Tanzania. I'm going to go direct to my presentation and share screen with you.
Can you put it on a presentation mode? Yes.
I've introduced myself. My name is Alfred Chengula, and I'm a co-founder. And I'm a co-founder of Imaratech. Imaratech is a startup company that deals with manufacturing of agricultural equipment for the use of smallholder farmers in rural Tanzania. Our vision is to bring prosperity, resilience, and sustainability to every farm in East Africa. How we connected with CRT? So in 2019, CRT is a partnership with one of the university from US. They conducted training in Tanzania to train local fabricator to make a mat crop thresher. So Imaratech, me and my fellow two co-founders, we attended that training and we got that knowledge of making the big thresher, as you can see on the pictures. So after we learned how to make this big thresher, then we go to the community and trying to do some research to see what kind of products that farmers gonna be able to buy and to use. And we came to realize most of the farmers are smallholder farmers who cannot be able to afford the big machine. And most of them, they wanted to have a small machine that they can carry it around and they can buy it with an affordable price. Then we designed one of our small MCT, which we call Matcox Thresher. And we did test it together with CRT, with partnership with TARI, to see the efficiency of the machine and making sure that the machine is more efficient, especially for the end users. But also CRT helped us much in promoting our product to different farmers in rural area. Most of the farmers in Tanzania, the big problem that they have is threshing their crops. So most of them, after harvesting their crops, they put them on the big pile of the ground, they get sick and they beat them until it fall off. That work is really tough, time consuming, and hard manual labor. It takes them to thresh for the common crops like maize and beans. It takes them up to 3 hours only for threshing a single bag. So Imaratech, we came up with this solution, which it turns those 3 hours of hard manual labor into 20 minutes for a crops like a beans, only for threshing a 90 kg. So for using this machine, it saved time, it saved labor, it saved money that most of the farmers are using for hiring many people for threshing their crops. But what's unique about this product is that we have designed it to use as a business, but also it has a modular design that's allowed to swap one piece of concave to change crops, because our product, it does 9 varieties crops, including beans, maize, sorghum, millet, and other crops. But also it's fast. It's 75 times faster than a traditional method. It's portable, fit on the back of motorcycle, which is very important to our customers. Like here on the picture is my brother Jose, who buys a machine and uses it as a business service by carrying it around, threshing crops from their neighbors, and enables them to earn up to $10 per hour and allows them to pay off the machine within one season. Our business model is we make this machine locally from the local technicians. So the way we make our machine is we contract many local technicians, we give them material for making our parts, then each local technician is making his own part, but we give them a sample. So after they make this part, we go, we correct those parts, we send them to our workshop where we do assembling and making sure we fix everything together and making sure that the quality of each machine is in a good quality. But also, the way that we sell this machine, we are working with different local agro vets who have the shops. So this local, agro vets, shop dealers, they have their shop where they are selling fertilizers, they sell seed, and they sell other agricultural equipment. So we give this product as a display unit to their shop. We train them how to sell our product. So after each sale that they're gonna be making, they earn commission in each sale. This allows us to sell our product in a big market, but also for the farmers, most of them, they trust these shop dealers because they belong to their community. And also it's very easy for them to get that product in a quickest way. But the other channel is that we are selling our product is through B2B, where we sell our products through to our NGOs, but also to the wholesalers who buy the machine in quantity, in big quantity, and they sell them to other clients, to their specific area. So the job creation for the community, in 2020, we managed to grow our team up to 10 people. This is permanent employee with an average of age of 28 that we have been in. To our company, but we have been able to contract 20 local technicians. These are the people who are making these parts that we are, once they make, we cross them. But also, we have managed to sell 120 machines for young entrepreneurs who bought the machine and use them as a business to their community. But also, we have 54 threshers that have been bought with the groups and NGOs in Tanzania. We believe through the sales that we have made for 2020, we have impacted over 10,000 farmers in Tanzania. In 2021, we are looking out to grow our team up to 20 people. These are the permanent employee, but also we are looking out to contract 40 local technicians who are gonna be making our part, but we are estimating to sell 400 machines to this young entrepreneur who are gonna use the machine as a business to their community. But also we are estimating to sell 100 threshers to the farmers groups and NGOs. but also through the sales that we're going to make for 2021, we are estimating to impact over 5,000 farmers in Tanzania. For the impact assessment of our pressure, this year we started up with the partnership with CRT to see how our product has impacted, especially women, by looking out before the and after adaptation of threshers, how their life has been changed and how even the quality of the product from the way they were using hand for threshing the crops and after the adaptation of the machine, how it has been changed. And this is our team that we work together in order to make sure we impact so many people in the areas that we are working with. Thank you so much for listening.
Thank you. Thank you, Alfred. Any questions on Alfred's presentation, please put it in the questions box. I now move to Uganda, where I will introduce Sheila Alumo, who is the Executive Director of Eastern Agricultural Development Company Limited. For those of you who are aware with the Karamoja region in Uganda, it's a fragile region. Cattle rustling is quite common. It's an area that is quite poverty stricken with food insecurity and very high malnutrition rates. So Sheila was a lawyer, and then she decided to move to the community to achieve some social impact through nutritional value addition activities and processing of beans as well as other crops. Sheila, please load your presentation.
Hey, everyone.
Hello, please put it on presentation. Put it on presentation mode. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. Sheila Alumo is my name. Kamara, thank you so much for the introduction. I am a CEO and founder, Eastern Agriculture Development Company Limited. We are an agri-business social enterprise based in Uganda. In the far eastern side of Uganda, which is about 320 kilometers from Kampala. And we work with a network of rural smallholder farmers in the fat-rich areas, like was earlier mentioned, in one of those areas being Karamoja region, Teso region, which are highly, you know, stricken with poverty and malnutrition rates. Basically, we are in a business of transforming livelihoods and the agribusiness ecosystem from a systems point of view. I will explain more of that later. Basically, right now we are a company with three shareholders, two being women and me the majority shareholder. We are governed by 7 board directors. We're in the business of trading and processing of super rich foods, rich in vitamin A, iron, and zinc, with plans to scale our processing because we have been doing small scale processing. We have integrated over 3,000 farmers into our digital supply chain, and we support them with access to clean planting material and extension services, as well as an assured market uptake for their products. As I mentioned earlier, we're in the business of transforming livelihoods and changing the agribusiness ecosystem, and our approach is threefold. So one of the issues that we're solving is malnutrition, access to finance, and environmental issues, which I think is pivotal to the transformation of the agribusiness food systems. And we all know the, you know, challenges of malnutrition to both, you know, impact on health and productivity. And the Karamoja region where we're working in right now is, you know, having the highest malnutrition rates in the country, with over 54% of children stunted, and majority of the community lives in abject poverty. And of course, malnutrition itself also impedes productivity, which is one of the causes, of course, of, you know, poverty. In as far as access to finance is concerned, or lack of it thereof, farming is a capital intensive venture, and looking at smallholder farmers who are a target group, and farming being their tool of trade, the absence of transactional history or data has made it an impediment for them to access finance, which in itself has, you know, definitely led to high, low productivity rates, and of course, high poverty rates, as due to lack of access to input credits. And since today, of course, is you know, World Pulses Day, and of course, we all know the benefits of pulses, high, rich in proteins, iron, zinc, we cannot underscore the fact that, you know, our actions in consuming pulses is also affecting the environment. We are actually destroying the environment because of the burden, heavy reliance on fuel. If you're in Africa, for instance, and rely, most of the fuel used is biofuel, which is the firewood, the charcoal, and there's a heavy reliance on the forest cover, which is, you know, also, I guess, one of the causes of the climatic changes that we're facing. So, as a business, these are some of the challenges, or would, some of the problems that we are solving. And some of the systemic challenges that are linked to the above mentioned problems, of course, is, as I mentioned, is inadequate capacity to process, which is critical, or value addition is critical to sustainability of the agribusiness value chain. And of course, productivity, low productivity, which is definitely very critical. And in as far as increasing incomes for farmer households, and of course, nutrition, and most importantly, sustainability of businesses. And these are some of the systemic problems that we are looking at, reliance on fuel for cooking, which some of my colleagues here have addressed. So basically, our approach is multifaceted and involves a link with, you know, research. It's an inclusive approach. And on the far right, as a, we believe in collaborations. I happen to subscribe to the, you know, old adage that says it takes a village to raise a child. And indeed, we've seen this work for us. So our approach is linked to research and collaborative partnerships with stakeholder partners like SEAD, CABRA, and other financial service providers and other development partners. So with our continued collaborative approach, we've managed to raise funding to enable us set up investment for processing for both the pre-cooked beans and the biofortified composite flours. Like I earlier mentioned, value addition is critical for addressing malnutrition, which I mentioned is one of the, you know, pressing challenges that is facing some of the target communities that we're working in. So we started last year, 2020, with product development of the pre-cooked beans. And we have, from our research and development, we have seen massive response from the consumers, consumer target groups. This year, we're now scaling to full-scale processing. We are in the process of setting up a 0.3 metric ton per hour processing plant for pre-cooking beans. And this we're doing in partnership or collaboration with SEAD and other strategic partners. And the other approach we are looking at, of course, is, which is in relation to addressing some of the systemic problems I talked about, is increasing our farmer base, production base. And of course, this again, we are doing in collaboration with partners like SIAT, CRS in Karamoja, for instance. We'll be working with about 1,000 farmers in production just in this year, and with plans to reach about 3,000 farmers in the three regions that we're working at. We are not going to look, the other embedded services, of course, that we are offering is access to agro inputs, financial services and extension services. We've also managed to create a market for our products, so, which is about 33 metric tons just alone for the dry beans. And we've gotten letters of intent from about three schools to the tune of about 10 metric tons per month for the pre-cooked dehydrated beans. And of course, we are integrating the village agents, and this is creating job opportunities for the youth, because the village agents are youth and women that are, you know, finished of completing the process of aggregation and cash outs. On the left, far right, sorry. These are just some of our successes. Like I mentioned, we have over 3,000 farmers integrated into our digital digital platform. We have 6 agents, and we are, you know, looking at scaling, reaching 10 by the end of this year. And of those, 4 will be women. And we've supported the 6 agents with smartphones. Again, this has been in partnership with SIAT. And we have enabled 200 farmers to open bank accounts. And with the partnership with Equity Bank and SIAT again and MasterCard, we are on the road to have about 800 to 1,000 farmers within 2021 with active bank accounts and able to access input credit. We already have an existing MOU with a bank, and they are willing to avail farmers with input credit. So all of these solutions are linked to solving the problems that we mentioned above. Here are pictorials of the bank supporting farmers to open bank accounts. And then on the far right is a sensitization, a digital sensitization exercise taking place in Karamoja region. Then the other, of course, one of the other, you know, solutions that we employ is low productivity and, you know, poor PHH is by training farmers in collaboration with NACRI and SIAT. And to date, we have about 900 farmers that have been trained on GAPS and PHH. And we're on track to reach over 2,000, about 2,000 to 3,000 farmers in the next 3 years. But for this year alone, we will have about 1,000 active farmers in production. So all of this we've been able to achieve through the interlink and collaboration with the strategic partners. Seed access is very critical, not just seed, but good seed access, good quality seed access is critical for sustainability and poverty eradication. And one of the key elements in our solutions is ensuring farmers are able to receive good quality seed through our collaboration with NARO or NACRI. And one of the varieties that we are promoting are the iron-rich beans, which are critical in addressing the malnutritional deficiencies of iron and zinc. Here are our some of our products. In the middle, in the far left, are the two varieties of the iron-rich beans. This is the narrow bean 1 and 2 and 3. In the middle are the pre-cooked beans. This is still in pilot phase, and I mentioned that we are now scaling processing this year. These are the pre-cooked dehydrated beans. And of course, this definitely lessens usage, the burden on the environment by saving over 85% of fuel. My colleagues have elaborated so much on that. I wouldn't want to dwell so much on that. But basically, the move to value addition, of course, like I said, is one in addressing malnutrition, because on the right, we are processing composite bean-based flours added with the vitamin A, orange sweet potatoes, and iron and rich zinc beans, which again aimed at addressing the malnutritional deficiencies of vitamin A, iron, and zinc. And the pre-cooked beans are looking at addressing the cooking time and the burden that the cooking time spent on cooking and the burden on the environment and the women and etc. So this, we believe, is pivotal to transforming the agribusiness value system. On the table here, these are the impact metrics, but I'm going to just talk about two, three things. And on the first one is the farmers. This is, we look at the increase of adoption of farmers in production from about 800 to 1,000 in 2021 to 2,600 to 3,000 in the next, you know, 2-3 years. And all of this, again, is only possible because of some of the, you know, collaborations we have with the strategic partners, and of course because of the investments we're putting in place to enable value addition. And then secondly, we're also seeing an increase in revenues in production on the part of smallholder farmers. But most importantly, we're also seeing strategic growth in the business, maxing sales of nearly 800, you know, USD in the next 3 years. And this in itself goes a long way in creating sustainability and definitely changing the trajectory of the agribusiness systems. Basically the presentation is focusing on value addition for the pre-cooked beans especially, and without, of course, neglecting the biofortified flours. But in as far as the pre-cooked beans is concerned, the market viability for the pre-cooked beans seems to indicate the need for us to venture into processing of the pre-cooked beans. Today in Uganda, for instance, we are importing over 800 metric tons of canned beans, which is only affordable by the middle and upper scale consumers. However, our product, which is the dehydrated pre-cooked beans, will be offered to the consumer at a, you know, a lower or more friendlier rate, so to speak, of about $1.2 per kilo, as opposed to the $2.7 per 500 grams. And the opportunities or target group, of course, are the BOPs. If you look at the refugees, for instance, who heavily rely on biodiesel, we have over 1.4 million of those. The BOP consumers are over 10 million. And institutions alone, there's over 25,000 institutions in Uganda alone. And that alone seems to indicate, you know, the readiness or the opportunities for the pre-cooked beans business, which goes a long way, of course, to creating several social impact variables, as will be mentioned. And in terms of the technical viability of this innovation, of course, there is technical support available, and we are already collaborating with SEAT and PABRA to, you know, provide us with the much needed technical support in enable to support us in setting up the right, you know, processing line to be able to process, you know, the right product that would suit the market demands. In as far as social impact and viability is concerned, this innovation goes a long way, of course, on definitely impacting the environment by reducing over 85% of, you know, fuel usage on the environment, increased farmer incomes. From our cost-benefit analysis, we see farmers maxing about $500 to $600 per year from sales of grains to us, as opposed to the initial sales of about, you know, $150 to $250 per year. And of course, it also provides health benefits to the women, because then it lessens the exposure to smoke inhalation during meal preparation, and of course reduced burden on the women and girls in relation to the some of the, you know, social injustices they face in firewood collection in areas like Karamoja, for instance. There have been instances of rape, you know. So our innovation goes a long way to definitely creating sustainable businesses for both the farmers and EADC, the company, but also to creating both direct and indirect impacts to the beneficiaries and transforming the agribusiness food systems. In conclusion, yes.
Okay, in conclusion, thank you.
Yes. Yeah, so in conclusion, what I would want to say is we can't underscore the role of research and collaborative partnerships in definitely transforming, you know, the agribusiness, you know, ecosystem, because where we are today because of some of those, you know, collaborations that we have been able to build. So I want to thank you.
Thank you very much, Sheila. Again, if there are questions for Sheila, please put them on the chat, on the questions box. Before we draw lessons and look at the way forward, I'd like to change gears a bit. One of the key challenges in SMEs is access to finance. So on one hand, lenders are wary of lending to SMEs and even to agriculture sector in general because of the various risks. And on the other hand, SMEs need to be present themselves as bankable so that they can be able to access finance so that they can attract lenders. So I'd like to introduce Aseli, Richard Bidirika, to make a presentation on what they do to be able to address this access to finance gap. Richard, please load your presentation.
Hi, Joseph, can you see me?
Yes, please go ahead.
Great, thank you. Let me also just put on my camera. Okay. So my name is Richard Midikira, with Assembly Africa. I'm the technical assistance manager for Assembly Africa. And in the interest of time, I shall attempt to make my presentation in the shortest time possible. And we can start off by, you know, doing an introduction into who we are at Assembly Africa. Joseph, how do I move my presentation forward? Okay, right. So by way of introduction, Assembly Africa is a donor-funded organization whose mandate is to bridge the gap between the supply and demand for financing in the agricultural sector. And we are doing this across four countries, that's Kenya, Rwanda, Uganda, and Tanzania. Now, our focus within the sector is on agri-SMEs, and we recognize that SMEs form the link between smallholder farmers and the market, and therefore have the potential to really transform the sector. More productive SMEs will result in more impact being delivered at the smallholder level through increased incomes, but also they'll be able to effectively meet the demands of the market. So I also recognize that, you know, some of our anchor donors are STC and USAID, who are represented in this call. Our other anchor donor is IKEA Foundation. Right, so our focus areas at SLE are financial incentives to lenders, technical assistance to SMEs, and data and learning. In terms of financial incentives, we have developed an incentive program on the basis of research that was undertaken to understand the economics of agri-SME lending. This was done by reviewing loans, over 9,000 loans from 31 lenders, just to understand why it is that there is suboptimal lending to agri-SMEs. And the research broadly revealed that, number one, lending to the agricultural sector is twice as risky compared to other sectors, and that returns from agri-SME lending are 4 to 5% lower compared to returns from lending to SMEs in other sectors. So in response to this, we designed incentives consisting of three components. Number one is a first loss cover, and this is designed to address the inherent risk in agri-SME lending. And we aim to increase lender risk appetite through our first loss cover. The second component is an origination incentive payment, and this is to increase returns to lenders for the additional costs of underwriting and managing particularly small agri loans. The third component, which is captured in the lower section of the presentation, is impact bonuses, whereby we reward lenders for lending to high impact businesses. And in Asali's context, we look at impact from three lenses. Number one is gender inclusion. Secondly is climate smart and resilient agriculture. And number three is food security. And all these impact areas align to Pabra's work. Pabra is a very central partner to SLE, not only from the financial incentives perspective, but also in terms of technical assistance. So for the financial incentives, to date, we have accredited 18 lenders since September 2020. And this consists of commercial banks, social lenders, and non-bank financial institutions. And given that we have a specific focus on youth and women-owned agribusinesses, what would be interesting as a source of funding would be the social lenders, as these tend to be more driven by impact rather than financial returns. And as I mentioned, are a potential source of financing for women and youth-led enterprises. So far, we have $2.7 million in loans registered with the SELI for the financial incentives since September. And what is interesting to note is that we're really seeing a shift in behavior of lenders, whereby they are shifting their risk frontier to target what is perceived as riskier SMEs. Some of them are lowering their minimum loan ticket sizes in order to benefit from our financial incentives. We are also encouraged by the fact that we are seeing a lot of the lenders lend to non-cash crop value chains. So traditionally, we have lenders leaning towards value chains such as coffee, tea, and high-value horticulture. But a majority of the loans that have been registered with the SELI are to food crop value chains, including a loan to enterprise engaged in the bean value chain. So, you know, in the spirit of the World Pulses Day, this is very encouraging. And in 5 years, we hope to catalyze $700 million in incremental lending to the agricultural sector. So this is something that we look forward to at SELI. The second piece of the financing access to finance puzzle is the technical assistance. And through our TA programs, we set out to build particularly the management capacity of SMEs to develop viable, sustainable business models and practices to be able to access and deploy finance. It said that ultimately there's no lender or investor who turn away a good deal, and our TA is designed to help SMEs present the best deal possible. In line with our impact agenda, we're especially keen on working with youth and women-owned enterprises to enhance access to finance. And again, it's encouraging to see some of the enterprises on this call participating in our pilot TA program. And we are keen on working with partners like Pabra and other partners who have a direct interface to these women and youth-owned enterprises, to refer them to Assembly for our TA programs. I would also like to finalize by mentioning that our online application for the second cohort of the Grow Your Group Business Program is now live. And if you need any information, please reach out to me via email. You can get my email through the Pabra team. I will stop there for now. Thank you, and welcome any questions.
Thanks a lot, Richard, and also for being on time. So the last session is drawing lessons and looking at the way forward. And I'd like to invite the Director of Crops Research in the Department of Research and Specialist Services in Zimbabwe, Dumisami Kutuayo, to make some remarks. If you can take about 5 minutes, and then Joe Tome, the Director of Crops for Nutrition and Health in the Alliance of Biodiversity and SEAD, will also make some remarks for 5 minutes. So, Dumisami, over to you.
Okay. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen.
Yes, I would like to share our lessons learned from the partnership between the Alliance and the Department of Research and Specialist Services in the Ministry of Agriculture. Is it there now? Where should I show?
Choose the presentation.
Okay. Let me see, where am I? Show on the main screen.
Right, okay. Now it's on the email screen.
Is it there now?
No, if you go to PowerPoint and then you choose the presentation.
Okay. Then PowerPoint, okay. Yes, it's there now, yes. So you've given me very little time. I hope I'll be able to do that within the shortest possible time.
Okay, thank you.
All right. What are the key institutional factors and achievements of our collaboration with the ABC through PABRA in Zimbabwe? I think we witnessed some transformative partnership through the multidisciplinary research team approach, which included the research scientists, extensionists, the private sector partners and pharma groups. And all these participated in the generation of various key technologies, including demand-led varieties and accelerated seed access. For instance, in the last 10 years, we registered canning varieties, some of which are biofortified. These have enabled the canning industry to engage local producers to supply canning bean grain to reduce dependence on imports. For example, we're spending up to about 120,000 US dollars in importing canning varieties. So this is in support of government policy on import substitution and thereby saving a lot of foreign currency. Then another transformative activity was the value chain approach involving both the private and public sectors. And this involved the input suppliers, the seed companies, public sector research and extension, and smallholder farmers, including women farmers who were able to participate in the seed systems. So for example, our seed supply system increased from 520 tons in 2015 to 1,900 tons per year during 2020. What are the issues? We benefited from alignment with national priorities, which was accelerated. For example, the biofortified bean with high iron and zinc content for nutrition was factored into the food fortification strategy. And this helped to scale uptake of biofortified varieties in the health and education institution, reaching 8,000 households in 2015. And we, as we speak now, last year, 2020, we had more than 170,000 households. This, we all realized this through the strong partnerships between ourselves, PABRA, and also the LFSP program, where FAO and Harvest Plus were participating as well. So the PABRA model helped to transform the bean sector to a very vibrant one, to the extent that we had the bean research team winning awards for doing very well in terms of the biofortified bean. And the regionality of the PABRA helped the National Bean Program to benefit from members of the networks, you know, with the SABRIN, which is Southern Africa Bean Research Network, and also the SABRIN. And we were able to benefit by getting germplasm and fast checking this to develop in other member countries. Then the partnership developed some products that attracted the private sector players to scale and create multiple benefits. For example, the canning industry that I already alluded to.
So we also had an increase in the utilization of nutrient-dense bean-based products through multi-stakeholder value chain approach. Various actors, including women and youth, were engaged to process bean-based value-added products, such as the baked bean, the maize bean sump, the bean flour, maheu, which is our energy drink, you know, based on cereal and bean mixture, and also some fritters. These were promoted and distributed in supermarkets and restaurants. And for example, we had 3,000 people having access to these in 2015 and 96,000 people as of 2020. And the numbers continue to increase. This is the bean planting period, and there's a lot high demand now for the biofortified bean. Then the PABRA module was able to bring together global research and national priorities together. So the model allowed the National Bean Program and Alliance to work together to solve national agriculture development bottlenecks.
Sorry, Dumisani, sorry to interrupt you, but the presentation is stuck. So I don't know if you are going through the pages, but we see only the main, the first slide.
For me, yeah, it's going. For me, I'm now on lessons learned. I don't know what is happening on that side.
Maybe try to deactivate and reactivate the presentation. Maybe there's a green button near the microphone with a screen, with a monitor. Just click on it to disable and then re-click to enable. Perfect. Okay, now click on it.
I click on the...
On the monitor, sure. Yes. Yes.
Okay. Are we together now? Are you on the...
Not yet.
Which slide are you seeing?
No, not yet.
Okay. On the green button after the video,
Yeah, there's a button with a monitor near the microphone.
Yes.
And near the webcam button.
Is this the one? This is just for my picture.
No, this is for the webcam.
For the one on the bottom.
This one is for the webcam. There is another one near them.
So can you see me now?
No.
Not yet.
Maybe Valerio, we can follow the remarks just as he goes through the presentation.
Okay. So
yeah, just go ahead.
Where we are now in terms of lessons learned is that the model has allowed the National Bean Program and Alliance to work together to solve national agriculture development bottlenecks and delivery of relevant solutions. The model has helped to build the capacity in terms of scientific knowledge and skills, and also cross-cutting soft skills of our bean program, and to broaden its scope. For example, the multidisciplinary approach in the R&D coupled with stakeholder-driven research prioritization has led to sustainable transformation of the agriculture sector. Therefore, the other issues on the innovation platforms, they are a must in the dissemination of technologies as they allow all stakeholders to contribute to the value chain development. Additionally, the awareness on key nutrition issues is key, and this needs to be done at all levels through multi-stakeholder inclusion, for example, at research, extension, health, education, and social welfare, to ensure that all stakeholders are involved. What are the policy changes that is taking place as a result of our partnership with the Alliance? We have seen the mainstreaming of multidisciplinary approach across all crops. I can cite the soybeans, the beans that are already adopting the approach that was used in the bean project. And also we have seen the mainstreaming of the private sector engagement across all commodity research. And also the mainstreaming of biofortification into the national food fortification strategy. In addition, all bean varieties to be registered in Zimbabwe now have to be tested for micronutrient density, particularly iron and zinc. And we've also seen the biofortified crops being integrated into the school feeding programs at primary school level. I think those of you who have been to Zimbabwe have seen that a lot of primary schools now have nutrition gardens, and the biofortified varieties are a key element at those gardens. Then the adoption of the innovation platform approach in national food security initiatives, for example, soybeans that I have already alluded to, wheat and maize. We are now making sure that all stakeholders are participating in this. And also, as part of the skills development that I have talked about, we've seen the adoption of digitalization in crop assessment studies at the national level. With those few remarks, I would like to thank you. I'm sorry that you couldn't see my slides, but that's over now. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Joe Tome, over to you.
Thank you. Very impressive set of presentation, and it really take us back to the mission of PABRA, how to strengthen the national system and how to address the SDGs in a very urgent matter. What I would like to do very quickly is highlight what are the lessons learned, at the same time kind of articulate some way forward that PABRA and the BEAN team has been kind of considering in consultation with our partners. It was mentioned several times about the unique partnership and the governance systems of PABRA. If you look at the international collaboration, PABRA is stand aside as a unique setup of partnerships that include national priorities, at the same time kind of the donors' kind of interest to advance our fight against malnutrition, poverty, and increase economic development. The second point that we got out of 25 years of PABRA is the importance of multidisciplinary teams. This has been kind of central to PABRA involvement in the region. Multidisciplinary teams that push innovation platforms at different level, integrating different aspects from foresight, gender analysis, gender investment in gender equity, at the same time breeding and seed systems. And the last lessons learned is the importance of long-term investment. And this is thanks to our donors that had this vision of a continuous investment in PABRA that allow us to see the reward that was presented today. In terms of what are kind of the way forward, I would like to highlight four areas. One, how we are going to accelerate innovation. Several speakers mentioned the breeding aspect. This is something that we are investing as part of the initiative of donors involved in Crop to End Hunger initiative. The second is that how we are going to address the digital divide. Yeah? Innovation platform that will tap into the digital revolution, but at the same time kind of address the digital divide. New model of seed systems and for delivery. And we're seeing several aspects, several speakers alluded to it, but PABRA and the colleagues have a broader portfolio on increasing delivery through innovative seed systems. And then the second point that I would like to make is that how we're going to ensure gender equity and social inclusion. There is several innovation implementation aspects that are taking place within PABRA that hopefully will be able to expand our activities to ensure gender equity and social inclusion. The third point is that PABRA and the BEAN program has already a proven record in nexus between agriculture and nutrition. Biofortified crops, it was mentioned in several occasions today. What we would like to do is expand this nexus on agricultural nutrition to health. There is several studies that point to the importance of beans, among other crops, to address health issues from obesity, type 2 diabetes, and colon cancer. Some recent studies funded by NIH, Michigan State, Colorado State, University of Washington in Missouri, that point to kind of the importance of incorporating a healthy diet for addressing some aspect of the triple burden of malnutrition. And finally, PABRA is investing a lot of effort in tackling climate change at different levels. And this is going to be a central point of some of the activities that we'll be carrying in the next few years. So in terms of way forward, is accelerating innovation, ensuring gender equity, expanding the nexus from nutrition to health, and addressing the climate change crisis. Finally, on a personal note, exactly to the same day last year, I was in Kampala with the PABRA colleague had discussing the annual plan. Unfortunately, I will not be able to do it this year, but I would like to take this opportunity to express the gratitude of the BEAM program and PABRA to all the staff, national and international, that allow us to deliver during a difficult year in 2020, and also the commitment that the whole team has for delivering on our commitment to donors in 2021 under very complex circumstances. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Joe. And I will welcome comments from our development partners. I'll start with Peter Bila of SDC, who is the head of Eastern and Southern Africa Division. Thank you.
Yes, good afternoon, dear colleagues. It's a pleasure to see you, to see these presentations today. They were very impressive. I was very happy to follow all of them, very interesting. And needless to say that SDC is very proud to be a long-term partner of PABRA, and finally having the opportunity also to see the results after so many years. Let me give you a couple of personal impressions that I have after these presentations, as we are in a stage of now appreciating the results, and results that are highly impressive, and I think highly impressive also substantiated by the many studies that have been done previously, and that underline the real advances that PABRA has been doing. We've learned that bean farming today has long gone beyond subsistence farming, and I think that's an important message to convey outside. Bean farming is not subsistence, but it has become a commodity that is tradable and that is interested for the private sector. That was very visible today, and I think that's important. Second thing is that bean research is definitely not only breeding. We have very well seen that bean research also includes gender, environment, small business development, nutrition, so important, food processing and trade. That means it goes well beyond the bean research per se, that was often related only and put back in a corner of breeding. It has also shown that rural development in this sense is not only farming, but it's business opportunities and opportunities for youth particularly. And we've seen quite a few examples of youth initiatives, youth businesses that are working now in rural livelihoods and based on rural livelihoods, and contributing to this rural transformation that we all look eagerly forward to happen to some extent as soon as possible. The presentations have also shown that the collaborations at an early stage with all stakeholders is absolutely crucial. Breeders talking with nutritionists and private sectors, and above all together with farmers, I think that's the model we need to remember, and we need to keep up to make this whole chain, as we've seen it today, working perfectly well. With all these appreciations, I think we can really congratulate for this World Pulses Day. This is an anniversary, let's say, and I'm likely to say there are many more to come, because the task that we are supposed to do is not finished yet. And there are challenges, and we heard a few, and I would like to stress three of them that I find particularly interesting. First one is as a challenge, definitely to keep the market in view. I think I'm absolutely sure that the processed beans, as several examples have been presented today, have a high potential also in urban settings. So middle class in urban settings is probably still interested in beans once it gets to this product. So there is probably a business opportunity there also, besides the nutrition that we tackled already on a probably a different scale. Second challenge that I've seen is this rural transformation still. And with rural transformation, one or two presenters have underlined it, that the modernization of agriculture is very important. And I think we have to be careful not to lose the farmers out of view. One presenter has said that agriculture is a high-risk investment, and I think the first investors into this business and into beans as such are the farmers themselves, and in my opinion, we shouldn't lose them out of sight, and maybe consider also access to finance and access to production inputs a little bit closer. And the third input to close with my intervention is just to stress what the previous speaker has just finished as well, is climate change. Please don't forget climate change. It's not in front of our door, it's inside our room, and we have to tackle it fast. And I think PABRA has a key role to play. Thanks a lot, and again, congratulations for this presentation. Congratulations to PABRA's work. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Peter. And this could not have been possible without, you know, the long-term commitment of SDC, of course, GAC, and other partners. The next speaker is Kelly Thompson, who is the First Secretary of Pan-Africa and Regional Development in the High Commission of Canada in Kenya. Kelly, please welcome to make some remarks.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you very much to the organizers for putting together this presentation. As you know, in these pandemic times, we do not have the opportunity to come and do site visits and monitor close up. So it's really through the webinars that PABRA and SEED have been putting on over the past year that I've been able to track the progress of our investment. And like SDC, we're very proud to be contributing to this initiative and to PABRA's focus, PABRA and SEED's focus on food security, youth and women's empowerment, and nutrition in the region. I don't want to go on too long because we're already well over time here. I just want to acknowledge the important work that SEED and PABRA are doing to increase the nutritional value and awareness of beans as a key element of food security in Africa. And PABRA and SEED, as everyone has said along the way, cannot succeed in this work without the important partnerships and the partners that are gathered here today around the table. So I want to thank all of those people, the government representatives, the policymakers, the researchers, the entrepreneurs, the civil society representatives, especially the farmers, as well as the other donors. To all of you, thank you for your contribution and for keeping the very significant and impressive work of PABRA and SEED going over many years in the case of the Swiss and Canada. Myself, I've only been involved in the past 2-3 years, and I've seen this initiative introduce innovation, increase smallhold farmers' productions and revenues. And this in spite of the setbacks of locusts and pandemics and extreme weather events. So that's been impressive because we could certainly anticipate that there would be downturns. And yet keeping the focus on agriculture as an essential service and supporting people through alternative methods like the digital corridor platforms, et cetera, we've managed to maintain the momentum in this important work. So that's impressive in itself. I've been particularly impressed, and it's been underlined today, the support that's been given to women and youth entrepreneurs and to help them create and sell value-added products. And we really heard some impressive testimonies today of how well that's working and how every year seems to be increasing production and revenues and employment. So that's great. And this innovative work has also extended into facilitating financial access to finance, which we know is one of the greatest barriers for smallholder farmers if they want to do any scale up. So we saw that today exemplified in the partnership with Aseli Africa, and we've seen it in previous webinars with the linkages with MasterCard Lab and their support of a digital network that facilitates financial transactions. So today we listened to some of the lessons learned that have been integrated back into the programming over the years to help beneficiaries to deal, well, this year, it helped them to deal with COVID more effectively and to better protect their productivity and their revenues and to benefit from technology, including promoting digital inclusion. So these many successes have also led to, I think, a strong commitment from governments that have been able to align PABRA's work with their national strategies and to the donors as well, as they're able to help us achieve our hoped for results in terms of having development impact. And I know at the last minute, Peter mentioned, don't forget climate change, don't forget the environment. I guess I would like to add to that, you know, don't forget about biodiversity, which is an important element of some of the constraints that have come from climate change and that need to be focused on. And in terms of women's empowerment, don't forget about unpaid work that in pandemic times has taken women out of the fields and out of the offices and out of entrepreneurship opportunities, to stay home with kids who aren't in school, to stay home with family members that are sick. And so there's another frontier to tackle, I think, in order to empower women to be more involved. So I want to thank the PABRA team for putting this webinar together and for your hard work to promote beans for a healthy diet and a healthy planet. So thanks very much.
Thanks very much, Kelly. And the hands-on nature of our partnership is really appreciated. Always keeping the impact orientation, you know, as the goal, so we don't lose focus. Thanks a lot. The next speaker is Eric White from USAID. Eric is the Agricultural International Affairs Specialist. Eric, please welcome to make your remarks.
Yes, hello everyone, and very happy to be here. Thank you all so much for the wonderful set of presentations today and for allowing me to join in the celebration of all that you've accomplished. I will make my comments brief as we are quite over time and I think much has been said already. But I do want to emphasize, I think some of the points that were made earlier. I think one of the early presenters talked about how this fits well with the one CGIAR change. I have to say that I think even more than that, really the program that's been modeled here over the years on the participatory breeding and the demand-led breeding that includes a wide range of partners and to build capacity in national programs is really something that can be shown to many other parts of the agriculture breeding research world as a real model for how to get this right. And I think the presentations today show that this is a mature program that has gone on to link into other parts of the agriculture value chain around beans that are truly exciting in the way they expand and taking a look at other issues besides just how to do the breeding better. A particular, the points that Joe made about the impact on climate change and the impact on nutrition being so central to what the Pabra can bring to the table is really really key to our continued support to this. So I'll leave it at that, and just thank you so much for all the work that you've done and for allowing us to be a part of that in a small way.
Thanks a lot, Eric, and your support, especially to the work on seed systems, is very much appreciated. Seed is really the threshold of where you can get in terms of productivity. Without that, even with a lot of inputs, it is difficult to achieve the gains that we would want. So I'll introduce the next speaker, who is Elea Ndungu of Australian Centre for International Agricultural Research. She's the Regional Manager for Eastern Southern Africa. So Leah, welcome, and please make your remarks. Hello, Leah. Your microphone is unmuted, but we cannot hear you. Hello, Leah, can you hear us? Maybe we start, we move to Jeff, and then we'll come back to Leah. Jeff Ellers is a Senior Program Officer for Research and Development at the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and also very passionate about pulses, you know, having worked for many years on cowpea. Jeff, please make your remarks. Jeff? Okay. Leah, can you hear me?
We can hear you, Josie.
Oh. Okay. So maybe I'll welcome our Managing Director for Africa, Susan, to give some closing remarks before we close. And you can reach out to us through our Twitter handle. It is _Pabra. Susan, over to you to make some closing remarks, and then we conclude.
Can you hear me? And can you see me?
Yes.
So, like my predecessors, I will try to be brief, but what a day to celebrate Pulses Day today. We have heard and witnessed through our partners' presentations example of best practices and innovations contributing to raise the awareness and the role of beans in elevating poverty and fostering entrepreneurship, and even more so visibly among women and youth. What I would say is that the sustainable production of beans contributes to SDGs 1, 2, 3, 5, and 8, and 12, as it's been said before, but that even more so, it is part of the diets and the way of life of many of our African brothers and sisters. On behalf of the Alliance and the team, I wish to thank our government partners, private sector partners, our investors, visioners, believers in the PABRA program for participating in this event and for their continued support. And without further ado, I will close the meeting. Thank you very much to the team for putting up this brilliant meeting, for the colleagues for participating. See you next time.
Thank you, Susan. Yes.
Thank you, everyone.